Thank you, Bob, for your kind words, and thank you. I'm not quite sure if I can put this. I guess I can put this right here. And thank you very much here in the community for loaning out John Claiborne today. He gave me a delightful tour of Philadelphia. It all began with a tour of your wonderful charter school, Chad, and I was inspired by the whole notion that design can really play a huge role in education, and I really applaud the Philadelphia community for creating something like that. It really, I could feel the difference it was making as I met the students and the teachers, and I, for one, I know that I discovered design when I was in high school. I had a remarkable art teacher who just happened to be an architecture professor, an architect, and he gave me, first he instilled upon me some confidence that I could actually draw, paint, and then he showed me what design could mean, and he created a lifelong passion for me that I am incredibly grateful for, and I can kind of see that that's going on in that school, and so it's terrific that you're doing that. And I also want to thank you for inviting me to this important lecture. It's a great honor. Lou Kahn, like I'm sure for many people in this room, has had a profound impact on my approach to architecture. It's always a delight to get to walk through one of his buildings. And just the appreciation, even not even just walking through, just thinking about them often, and the memories of those spaces and the simplicity of the design, and then the fact that the buildings are often so particular to their place. That my daughter works in the museum at Yale, and I get to go through that building, and then the Kimball in our own backyard in Fort Worth, and each very appropriate to their particular places, one on a New Haven street, and one kind of almost picking up on the vibrations from the barns that are kind of a couple of blocks away at the Kimball. And this whole notion of particular and making something particular to its place and leveraging the materials that a particular area had to offer obviously has played an enormous part in, has played an enormous part in our approach to doing architecture. And look, John, we forgot to mention you. And anyway, this is all about John, wherever you are. And now I'd like to bring up John. John, come on. and Robert, perhaps. And then finally, Ted. All right, so here we are. And this notion of making buildings particular to their place is what I am very excited about now in architecture. The notion of just the process of making something and leveraging a particular place is not only makes it unique and beautiful, but it also makes it inherently sustainable. And I think, and that really is going to be kind of the story that I'm going to be talking about today. And one of the reasons, the reason we as architects so love, or the people of Marrakesh so love the streets of Marrakesh, are that they are unique to that particular climate and weather. Narrow streets, buildings close together, shade above. It's all about a hot, dry climate. Or, a wider sidewalk in Paris with its dappled light coming from plane trees. These are particular places and spaces that really respond to the weather. And buildings obviously should do that. For me, our architecture certainly really began where I grew up. I grew up on the coast in Corpus Christi as a sailor. I was very lucky, had access to a boat, and this whole notion of this appreciation for the weather and a good breeze. And then we also had a place in the country on the left, a place in the hill country, where we had a little shelter. It was an off-the-grid shelter that we would go to any weekend we possibly could. as a family. It was completely off the grid before off the grid was even a term. But it instilled upon me early on the importance of shade and a good breeze. I grew up making things somewhat like this. These images are actually an image of every year my firm, the whole office goes out to the ranch and stays for a whole long weekend, and we put up these kind of ad hoc shelters. But as a kid, this is exactly what we also did. We had the value of being able to just with line and canvas and just working, creating spaces in shady places. You know, even though we do work all over the country now, but without question, Texas had a profound impact on our approach as an office to the architecture. And it begins really with this very diverse landscape, from the plains of North Texas to the brushland, which is I'm very, very familiar with, of South Texas, to the high mountains of West Texas, to the, you know, where we get a great deal more rainfall, East Texas, of you know, dense pine trees, to the center of the state, which is where all the rivers begin, in the hill country, which is kind of more easygoing, softer kind of landscape. And then finally, to bordering all of this is the bays and estuaries along the Gulf Coast. And these landscapes very much scream for different solutions. So just even in our own backyard, even though those probably from Philadelphia think of Texas as one kind of big blank, same old thing all throughout, it's really got a, you know, a variety there to respond to. So that landscape has had a profound effect. And then a lot of the people who settled in the Texas area from the very beginning, like these kind of projects, they had to work with these conditions of you know, an incredible drought one day and a deluge of rain and hot and sunny and then a big cold norther coming through. And so you really needed to work with the weather, obviously, in these early vernacular buildings where these early citizens couldn't afford to get it wrong. And they were incredibly imaginative about how to make shade. So there's lots of great examples throughout Texas of interesting, innovative ways to just solve this one basic problem, which is the sun. And then throughout the regions, there's a myriad of different materials and different skill sets that the different areas of Texas have. And so the notion of leveraging those when you're lucky enough to work in these different parts is critical. Like, this is a road cut right outside of San Antonio. I never get tired. I drive by this cut all the time. The limestone runs dead flat in most of Texas. There's no folding or faulting. But it's the undulation, it's the erosion of these limestone areas, and then these dead flat bands that seem to exacerbate this kind of pretty subtle landscape that is so beautiful. And then in the areas where limestone is pretty prevalent, you get some really great examples of masonry at a good value. This is a photograph of one of my partners who's my same age, so this was a long time ago. But I love this photograph because this was the day that we discovered the miracle stone in Mexico, in Vallecillo, Mexico, a little town that's, you can see where the goats are living. But it was this great stone that came right out of the ground that had four already kind of weathered edges, and we built a whole house out of it. And it was just, you can just see, you know. It's just appreciation of particular places. We were working near Mexico, and it made sense. As Bob alluded to, the agricultural and industrial aspects of growing up in Texas have had a huge impact. This image on the bottom is a drawing of one of my partners did of one of my favorite views. It was a place where my house was right where this view came from, and it was a series of silos that were lined up along railroad tracks, and they had to run them because it was railroad tracks and the river, and so they had to run them in a line, and then the river makes kind of a turn. And I never got tired of just seeing the long shadows. You know, we don't necessarily have great seasonal changes like you do here in Philadelphia, but we do have the sun changes, and you know, and just watching these silos kind of work like a big kind of seasonal clock. And then these upper buildings, for those who don't know these are not very far from where the Kimball is, and so I like to think that Louis figured it all out from these buildings. And he didn't put the names on them, but he certainly could have. It would have been maybe. And then how, you know, and it, we appreciate the vernacular in these industrial buildings, not from a romantic perspective, but just really from a practical perspective. It just, you know, just appreciating the economy of moves. The image on the upper right-hand corner is a simple shade structure that ranchers had put up, strung up in a cattle pen where they're working cattle, and you can't get any shade in the middle of pens, and it was just cable and corrugated metal. Later you'll see, I'm not going to share with one of you, we did a whole an enormous outdoor area adjacent to the arena that we did for the San Antonio Spurs that was just a huge version of this. So, but it was just that notion that, you know, an economy of means. You know, a lot of these materials come from a place where you don't have a big timber, availability, and so it's welded pipe and steel that are really the economical means of building in certain parts of Texas, and then for us also the artists that work in the big landscape like Terrell and Judd have also had big impacts for us, just in the sense of that appreciation of this big open space. And so when David and I, have to pause for 1/2 second here to, as Bob mentioned, David and I started our office in 1984. And we started with projects just like this that were very simple projects that were out in the country where the goals for the client were all about connecting to the outdoors. And style very much took a back seat. It was just, how can we really, you know, celebrate this place? And so this house in particular had more porch than interior space and huge cupola to draw the air through it. It was all about how you could basically build a sophisticated tent in the country. And those are the kind of clients we had in the very beginning. They weren't big projects, but they really did allow us to make this effort at making buildings that were really appropriate to their place. Or like this project that was near the Rio Grande border, where there's this great tradition of brick building. And so we did the entire project out of brick. Or this is the one that Bob mentioned of recycling a steel building. When we had a really challenging, it began just from a client that had a really lean budget. And that was the idea. And we said, well, God, for that budget, we can't do much. We're going to have to recycle an old building or something. And that's exactly what we did. We actually did recycle a building from a cement plant and moved it out into the country. Well, as we were doing projects like this, it allowed us to really begin to create a consistent philosophy about how you would do architecture. And it also leveraged a lot of the things that I had learned growing up in the country, you know, work with the weather. Then later I was lucky enough to have Bill Turnbull at Stanford, who had an incredible appreciation for the landscape. And then I had O'Neill Ford, who was kind of our Louis Kahn, our local Kahn, who taught me an appreciation for honesty of materials and an appreciation for how things went together. And then David Lake, who taught me the appreciation of and the value of collaboration. So, we were doing projects like this, simple structures. I'm going to show you. This is my latest love affair has become, which is awfully nice to think that one still can continue to learn a little bit. As the kids have all gotten really, really sophisticated on the computers, my age group started kind of losing out. We didn't really have the ability to do all these amazing three-dimensional drawings that they can do. But the iPad has brought me back. And so now I find myself doing a lot of sketching on the iPad, and it's so great, and I can fire it off to these young bucks in the office and show them that we still can do stuff. But this is just because I've used this as shorthand on a lot of drawings, but the landscape, as you can imagine, has basically our work begins with the landscape. And so the iPad sketch and sketches like this allow me at least to sketch and think about that bigger landscape simultaneously with thinking about the program of a building. And it doesn't matter if it's a house or a really large project. I kind of think of them all the same way. And in this case, this sketch is of a large ranch in South Texas. It's an area, beautiful area, of sand dunes that are covered in oak moss. And they feel like islands in the middle of a big open grass sea. And so in this particular case, and this is a project way back, but here we are thinking of all of the black sections that you'll see are the more opaque parts of the program. And this could be anything. In this particular case, it's a house, so they're the bathrooms and the bedrooms for the most part, or kitchens. And then the lines are the spaces that are those in-between spaces that are kind of half a step indoors and half a step out. And so they're those spaces that are blurring the lines between indoors and out. And thinking of the program is a way of making space. Pretty Kahn-esque approach to doing things, I would think. Not lucky enough to have grown up with Lou, but the notion on this one, though, was that you parked in the shade of the trees, and then here you kind of get a better sense of kind of how the program works. But the idea of it, we had enough program, you could start rounding up space, kind of an oasis courtyard in the center, and so then this is what it looked like in real life. So that's just to give you a sense of how these iPad sketches work. But anyway, park in the trees, and then you have this kind of great oasis space. All the buildings and rooms were all along the perimeter, and they were oriented to the prevailing breeze. So the wall was to the north, where we get cold winds, pretty simple climate in South Texas, and then you get these nice cool breezes from the southeast. And so the rooms and the spaces were all designed as much as possible to connect to the outdoors. So it was very sustainable in the sense that there was less air-conditioned area, but really more importantly, the idea was to how just to be one with the environment. And so when we were doing these projects, the word sustainability was not ever used when we were doing them. And then one of my favorite projects kind of this era was this little simple hakal, as we called it. It was the kind of service program is in the thick bar. This was a completely off-the-grid little shelter for a neighbor at the time. Very modest structure, but it was all about how to work with the weather because we didn't want to use any. I mean, all the water off this roof was used inside the house, and then there was some photovoltaics that allowed us some fans. But it was all about screen and flaps and things that this is the north side, so you have a curving wall in the north to block the winds, drop the flaps down, and the inside, the thick stone wall. All these materials came from very nearby. You'd store the kids and the bathroom and the kitchen were all in the service section. I don't remember if Lou would store kids in his service part, but anyway. And then the bed on wheels, in case the weather was bad, you'd move it away from the screen edge. And as we were lucky enough to do more projects and they were kind of cranking up in scale, and not that this is one of those, but we were able to, we were lucky enough to get a really kind of fine-tune our philosophy, as I would say. And so what is that philosophy? That philosophy is, I was going to be really specific this time. I decided I would not wing it as much as usual, but I wanted to say so as these projects grew in number, scale, and location, so we were able to refine our kind of what I would call an our notion of being an intuitive partner with the environment. That instead it really became a little bit more focused, where the landscape and the buildings are an inseparable team. Where the forms, like with early vernacular architecture, are shaped by the climate and where the materials are of the place and where science and technology are combined with art and craft. And then ultimately, the buildings are inherently sustainable. And then the office is growing at the same time. But what's nice about starting an office with a partner and then being able to go slow in the beginning and really kind of fine-tune your philosophy, when others then joined our office, it was something that was really pretty easily embraced by others. And so I think what has been really wonderful about our office, which is these are kind of the, you know, these are this evolution. This is every year we go out to the ranch, and then we, at the very end of the, you know, Saturday night, we take this photograph. But because of that set philosophy, the notion that collaboration was always very important, I think we have been lucky enough that we're able to grow and still have an enormous amount of consistency, but I think even higher quality because it's touched by many hands that explore things beyond what we would have probably done as individuals. So I'm organized. Now I'm going to walk you through our work. And really, the idea is I kind of have a couple of projects that kind of illustrate our approach in the different landscapes that we work in. And I've organized them around the landscape because I kind of think of them that way. And our being Western architects, you know, we do a lot of work that is in a big landscape. We also do a lot of urban work, too. And so this will be kind of, it maybe gives you a slight warped impression of the work that we do. But the work that's in that's truly out in a landscape is more easily understood in terms of our kind of approach to the design. So the first project is all, these first two are about this big flat landscape, which, as you can imagine, is something that we're long on in Texas. This first project is the World Birding Center, which this is the area along the Rio Grande. It's an area that was once really a fertile valley. The Rio Grande would flood, irrigate these areas. It was vibrant scrub, kind of looked really more like the photograph on the right. Now it's more like the photograph on the left. This is this notion of what the river used to do. Now there's lots of dams on the river. There's a lot of funneled irrigation. It's a really different place. It now looks more like this. And our project is this land right here that's on the border adjacent to an irrigation channel. And all the great land, this was for a visitor center, education center for birding. The South Texas is an enormous flyway of birds headed down into Mexico. And so this is a really popular pastime in this area. And to the left of this irrigation channel is this really fabulous scrub, the Tamaulipan scrub. It's some of the original stuff that was there from the beginning of time. So it's an amazing little island of about several thousand acres of this scrub. But our project was on the old kind of abused onion field. And so at the first we thought, well, that's going to be tough. But in reality, you know, it was perfect. This is an opportunity to begin to talk about how a building could mend the landscape. And then we thought naturally about the buildings of that area, what would make sense, what kind of materials to use, always thinking of, you know, this direct connection of Lou and how what would he do down in the valley. He would build out of these kind of nice, simple barn structures, these simple vaulted buildings. But we created a series of parallel bars that run east-west, so they have the least amount of exposure to the north and to the south, I mean, to the east and to the west, so they have the most exposure to the north and the south. And that way you can capture the prevailing breeze, you can start to protect the courtyards. And the idea was, by breaking up the program into a series of courtyards, we could begin using the courtyards to start to demonstrate how we could bring the landscape back. We could have the visitor at this building could start to engage the landscape close up in shady spaces. And then we even imagined how we could start to transform the larger landscape, the onion field. And so here's kind of how the plan worked, the notion of working off the irrigation channel the idea of flood irrigation. So we were using the irrigation channel as a way of starting to flood irrigate. This is right after the project was finished. So really these very, very simple shell structures that you see a lot in this area of Texas, and creating as much as possible outdoor circulation. So from the very beginning, we're not only using less energy, but we're engaging the visitor in the landscape from the beginning. So shady spaces, all the water coming off these roofs are collected in cisterns, so a really easily identified system so that you start to understand how the building's working. This notion of in the courtyards, emulating how the Rio Grande used to work in this area of flood irrigation, which is an amazing way to bring a landscape back. And what was fun about these courtyards is that even though all the great scrub was, you know, at a distance to walk to, because it was shady and nice and pleasant in our building, and they were right adjacent to this new landscape that was developing, they actually discovered two butterfly species that they didn't even know they had in the valley, and it was because they were able to take a little bit longer, sit in the shade, and stare at the plants. So it was, it's been a really successful, and it was fun using these simple shell structures, which are so efficient with the use of material, and then using material that made sense in that area, the kind of the hollow clay tile and steel and concrete, things that weather well in that really pretty kind of salty environment too. And then when we did work out in the scrub, we thought a lot about how to be light on the land. And so we used these helical piers that remind me of little, you know, stiletto heels on this sexy little hawk tower. But the idea was to not use any concrete out in the scrub, just to do these twisted, you know, corkscrew construction, and just thinking a lot about how we were going to build before we were designing. Then another project that's in this kind of somewhat flat landscape is a project that's right on the edge of San Antonio. And San Antonio is, and these are both actually state projects. These were parks and wildlife projects. So they weren't just, you know, enormous budget projects, but obviously they had great goals and aspirations. In this case, this is downtown San Antonio, and our sole drinking water in San Antonio comes from our underground aquifer, and it's a recharged aquifer. And all the rain that lands out in this area goes through a porous karst limestone topography, goes down, and then is collected in these little caves underground, the aquifer, and that is our drinking water. So what's interesting about San Antonio is that it actually has one of the most forward-looking environmental programs, but they backed into it, but now they're getting quite proud of it, and it is that the only way to protect our aquifer was to limit the construction out beyond the edge of town. And so it's almost like a system that Portland did, but very, very different, kind of a real Texas way. Every two or three years, they ask the citizens to vote. The citizens have consistently, for the last three or four years, three or four voting terms, have voted with their checkbooks to buy more land. Now we're not buying land, but we're actually buying the rights for the development rights. But in any case, this is this preserve that was created, was one of the very first preserves to protect the aquifer. And so, and this is that landscape of kind of holy, wonderful, pretty little limestone streams and things like that. But our location was something that, because we couldn't actually build our building in the recharge zone, we had to build it on the edge. And so it was a really unusual spot. So we thought of the building as a wall building, a place that you park on one side. The main activity, the great kind of 8,000 acres, is over here. There's a little stream, but this is really pretty much the edge where we could build. So we created a building that felt more like a farmer's wall adjacent to a big open space. And we cleared this space. It had historically been cleared. It was kind of a floodplain area. And the program is pretty basic. There's a little bit of air-conditioned program, which is what these dark blocks are, which are offices and classrooms. But the really dynamic part of the program was the more of the education space. And on this project, we recommended that because everyone's coming to this park to engage the outdoor landscape, that the space, the main space, ought not to be air conditioned either. They're either going to come when it's good weather or not. And so we created kind of like a Japanese pavilion. Here's some of the some early models that we did. But the idea is that we made a very simple long stone wall that would gather up everyone and then steer them in the right direction. All the roofs were sloped to collect the rainwater, because the big story on this project was all about recharge, rainwater, collection. So very simple architecture that just brought all the water to one central place and was stored in these tanks to use for gravity feed. This also was an opportunity, unlike the one down in the valley. Here we are really in a slightly different area. This is an area that is pretty long on oil field work. This was a time when, this is, you know, prior to fracking and some of the things that are going on right now in this part of Texas, but so there was a lot of kind of opportunity to recycle oil field pipe. And so this is kind of, as I put it, this is this kind of treatise on 2 3/4 inch oil field pipe. Everything was done in 2 3/4 inch oil field pipe. The engineer played an enormous role in the way we designed this project. We used, you know, all these kind of trusses, anything to use 2 3/4 inch oil field pipe. And it was, you know, it was fun. It was one of those wonderful, fun experiences when the engineer is as proud of the architecture as you are. And this was this all screen building with these rolling walls to, you know, make it more versatile during inclement weather. And then the idea of the water coming off these and going down into the ground, almost collected like it would in an aquifer. But then we had a little photovoltaic that would pump it up so that everyone could immediately understand kind of how the water worked. We had a lusher landscape in amongst this one little area of the buildings to show the power of rainwater. Okay, so that's the flat landscape. Luckily, we don't always have to just work in these flat landscapes. We're lucky enough to get to work in other areas. And this is in the desert area around Phoenix. We started with a project there. This is we did this in collaboration with RSP, who's Joe Tindall, who's an old friend of Bob's, actually. But anyway, the beauty of the Phoenix area is the weather and the desert, and it's this landscape. But in our case, we were doing a new branch, a new polytechnic school for Arizona State University, and it was just a quintessential kind of project that we would get, which was an old Air Force base. And so we thought, God, we have the desert, and no, we really have an old Air Force base. Now, the desert is right around the edges of this old Air Force base, and this is what the campus currently or looked like as we started the project. So in order to make a really successful place, we felt it was critical to bring back that whole notion of a desert and really make a desert campus, a campus that could be nowhere else but in the area of Phoenix. And so what we thought of is that we would make a great mall. These are all these new buildings. These are some buildings that already existed. So on the north side of what would be the mall, we had some existing buildings, but we had enough square footage. We had 250,000 square feet and a variety of departments that we had enough square footage that we could really make an impact on this campus. And so we thought of, and then this is also an area where you get, when you do get rain, you get a monsoon, you get a deluge. And so the rain is really pretty challenging. And on the old Army base, they funneled everything underneath the asphalt, and they had all these intricate, you know, sewer water systems and stuff, collection systems. So we felt that it was critical to use the desert the way the desert normally used, and think of this mall as kind of a great wash, an arroyo that could handle all the water coming through the space and irrigate itself and bring back the desert. And then the reason we showed these courtyards in a kind of a darker green is that we imagined those as areas where we could use a little bit more water off the off the air conditioning systems, you know, the condensate and water off the roofs, collect it a little bit longer and create kind of lush oasis contrasting spaces. And so then this is kind of how the plan started to work. We lined up most of the buildings that we could in the east-west direction, same notion of trying to have as little exposure to low-angle sun. But where we did do buildings that needed to connect to kind of finish off the courtyards that had to run north-south, we thought of them as two parallel buildings, thought of them as buildings like you would see in Marrakesh. So in other words, narrow streets, outdoor spaces. So this is the wash that we took all those asphalt roads with, and so all the water that does come down on the surface is then run through this. All of this planting and all is, we did begin with an irrigation system just to get it established, but it is no longer necessary. It's all, exactly what you would get with their systems of rainfall, just because we have these little check dams. And then ultimately the water then ends up in a larger retention area that works as a great amphitheater. And all the materials that we thought of on this building were all the kind of things that make sense in the desert. A lot of metal, perforated metal, it was an armature for vines, all things that weren't, that didn't absorb a lot of heat. And then we created Main Street on the campus along the northern side, the northern side of the building, so that you're, no. Let's see, am I correct? Anyway, this is the shady side, so let's see. This would, anyway, I think you get I'm a little lost on this. If this is north, yes, right, makes sense. South's over there. Yeah, south's over there, north's on this side. Anyway, so you circulate, obviously, along the shady side of the mall. So you could do something like this, You could do a Jeffersonian mall, but it would be all out of desert planning. And if you just have one great shady side to work on, it would be very successful. And then we created what we called these big student porches, these things that would announce the different quadrangles. They were all about engaging the outdoors, encouraging students to stay on campus. And then we did these internal streets. This project had a lot of program in it. And so one of the sustainable solutions was to put a lot of that circulation program in outdoor spaces and just make them really cool. So we created this great shady screen up above, three stories up, like you would find in some narrow desert cities. All the infrastructure of the building is kind of running through these big fans, drawing air through it. And then when we did face to the east or to the west, using screen systems on those areas. So all very shady and cool, but still with great, all the classrooms having balanced light from two sides. But ultimately being able to, when you walk through this building, know where your classrooms were. So it was a way to break the scale down, too, of the buildings and then create these kind of smaller spaces that really celebrated the desert. One of the aspects of our office that I really love is that we also get to work at a small scale at the same time and sometimes even in the same places. And so in this particular case, this is a house that we were doing simultaneously with the Arizona State University. And it was just a small house, but in an area adjacent to a fabulous desert, but with kind of funny houses next door. And so the idea was how to create a place that celebrated the desert and the open space without knowing that you have these neighbors. And so it was all about creating walls and using the more public or private parts of the building to create, blinders, edit, things like that. And so this is what that project was at. One of the things that's interesting about, and one of the great things that Phoenix has to offer is because probably from just the things that Wright and Paulo Soleri and a lot of others that have been innovative in that area have brought to the table is just this fearlessness about building and working with interesting materials. And it's created a whole school of architects who are also builders. And we had one of those who's become a great friend and is doing a lot of our houses in other parts of the country right now. And it's so wonderful. You go to the job site and the person, went to Harvard Design School, but he's your superintendent. Anyway, it's been, but that's the kind of thing that also is something that some areas have and some areas don't have. And I like to think that that was part of leveraging what a particular area had to offer, was just those kind of construction abilities that are there. So another landscape that we're lucky enough to get to work in is into the Rockies. And so this is Montana and Colorado. And there, you know, it's a landscape that is not very forgiving. It's not a landscape of a lot of trees, at least in the foothills of the Rockies. When you build something there, you'll see it from a long ways off. And so the idea here is to how to kind of build into the landscape. In this kind of example, we created more sod roof on this house than traditional architecture, and this is the plan where we conceive the house with most of the kind of private elements of the house digging into the landscape, but kind of becoming part of this soft bench. And then what public rooms we did have, celebrate those in kind of more boisterous open spaces that lent themselves to being able to open to the outdoors. And so this is this kind of a drawing of how that worked, kitchens and bathrooms and all that kind of stuff, this dark black stuff. And then the idea of a room that you can shutter it off at certain times of the year, open it up, working with steel, which makes sense in an area where it's really, really dry, using some timber, concrete, where it was up against the sod roof. And then what it's like in that hunkered in area underneath the sod roof of kind of steel and cozy little cave-like spaces like this, and the ability to throw the house open in certain times of the year, so you could really take advantage of the temperature in the summer, fall, and spring, but then a radiant floor system during the winter. Well, I show that because that's just a predecessor to a project. I wanted to show you one project that we're currently working on right this second, started a couple of months ago. It's a project that I'm very excited about, and it is on the western side of Colorado near Grand Junction. It's an area of 9 inches of rainfall. It's an area of these kind of, you know, great mountain ranges, and it's kind of the mesa land. There isn't a lot of folding and faulting in this area. Very straight kind of sandstone geology here. These are kind of flat top mesas, and then they slough off down to these creeks and draws. This was an area that had once had a beautiful valleys that had high grass, the streams that would run through them. This is actually one that's in reasonable shape, but these streams used to meander slowly, high grass, you know, and it's a typical Western story. Cows were first brought in, farmers were then brought in. Before you knew it, the little streams were channelized, the beavers were killed, who used to be in charge of keeping the rivers all dammed up and nice, and you ended up with a landscape really of just sagebrush, which is this. And this is our site. The project, and the reason I wanted to share this with you, is it's exciting in that the land is owned by several individuals, but they own all the valleys, about 40,000 acres of valleys. But in Colorado, if you own the valleys, you then have you can have long-term ownership rights or user rights to the mountains. And so they actually control about 300,000 acres. And what he wants to do is start to restore all these creeks to the way they were. And it's a really fabulous idea, the idea of push dirt back into them, do all the things that, push all dirt back into these creeks, these kind of abused creeks. This is one of them right here. And then plant it with beaver food, you know, just all this great planting that the beavers cannot wait to do something with, and then let the beaver solve your problem. Because in Colorado, there's these draconian laws about how you can work with rivers and streams, which makes some sense and then some not so much sense, but the great thing that the beaver is not controlled by any of these rules, and so all you have to do is put the beaver back in charge. Anyway, it's a really novel, wonderful idea, expensive to start to restore these creeks, and then they also want to bring the wolves back, do all the things that you could imagine make sense in trying to bring this landscape back to its vibrancy, to what it was once like. And that wasn't very long ago when it was in great shape. So what the idea is to create a lodge that will pay for a new institution that would then start to do the research, and also the lodge would pay for the all of these efforts at restoring the landscape. There's kind of more to it than that. But this is our site, and it is a big alluvial plain. You know, this is currently irrigated. They have irrigation rights to do this. This is all this sagebrush. These are these fabulous views. This is the view of that space. And so this is the project. And so, you know, again, bringing in the iPad. Oh, by the way, this is an interesting project, too, in that this was one where the owner decided, they couldn't really decide on who they wanted to hire, so they ended up asking our firm and Jim Cutler, who I don't know if some of you know Jim, but Jim was a UPenn graduate a while back. Anyway, but Jim is got a smaller office, isn't always so used to. I think the last time he worked with someone was when he did Bill Gates' house, and he worked with Peter Bullitt. But Jim and I are playing well and really enjoying it, and both of us are big iPad sketchers, and so we send our iPad sketches back and forth to each other. It's been very interesting. But the idea is the whole program was to dig into this landscape, or the notion was we had enough program, but how do you avoid screwing up this amazing open landscape? How do you celebrate the open landscape? And so the idea was that the majority of the program would be a bench into this alluvial plain. It would feel just like an eroded edge, as if the stream had eroded it, and then bringing back the stream along this. So you have this contrasting world, the things that can come from having water, and then just that desert sage up above, and the building kind of in the transition zone. And so we imagined it like this house that we did in Colorado, sod roofs, but in this case, sod made of sage. This is an early sketch of Jim's, just to show you we're still big sketchers, and so this is a lot about how we were communicating back and forth, and then as those ideas evolve, what it's like to have simple barn structures sitting on the sage, the idea of the spaces in between these pavilions having, you know, qualities kind of like this. So again, just sketches going back and forth, thinking as we always do in our projects, of thinking about what the material is going to be like. In this case, we're going to need, because we're holding up the earth, we're going to be using concrete. And so the notion of how you can use concrete in a really rough and beautiful way that can resonate with this place. Also, by doing concrete that's less precious, it would be more logical that it would turn out well in an area as remote as we're talking. So this is not one of those places that you needed to have, you know, all of it all perfectly figured out. And then there's just these kind of sketches of what it's like to enter first from the sage above and then dropping down, and then the quality of the spaces kind of underneath that sage. And then at the same time as we're doing all those thoughts and these sketches of the spaces, we're very much thinking about the science. We in our office have a sustainability coordinator, an engineer, and so in the earliest stages of design, and this is just in conceptual design, we're thinking about how to work with the weather. And so the notion of benching in, yes, it would make sense in the sense that we would have less impact in this beautiful valley, but it also made a lot of environmental sense. We could use the mass of the earth. There's a cold wind that naturally comes down from the valley, and so by benching up against that, we're staying out of the way of that cooler breeze. We're capturing the cooler or the cold breeze from up valley. We're capturing the breeze that's coming up valley, that's that cooler breeze, the breeze you want, flushing it through the building, thinking about the quality of light. But probably one of the most important strategies, I didn't mean to have all these, I'd forgotten I had all these, I'll test you on all this stuff. But one of the things I think that was a really important aspect of early design on this project was talking to the client about when they would use the building. You know, the great, you know, the way it works in this part of the country is that, you know, the buffaloes used to migrate, so why shouldn't humans migrate? So we talked about the notion of let's design this building for when you really, really want to be using the building and just close it down. And so that's basically now we're designing in the notion that we could have radiant floor heating in the future, but the idea is to design really well for that particular thoughtful time of the year. And so that allows us, for the most part, to do most of this building without any forced air mechanical systems. And so then this is kind of how the plan worked of lodges and institute and spaces like that. Another landscape that, you know, there is water in the West and there is more abundant rainfall in parts of Texas, East Texas in particular. And this image, this is the, just, I'm just going to show one project in this category, but it, this is really a project that's more in what I would call a transition zone. It's that space between rural and urban. And in this case, we had an amazing, this is East Texas, near a little, a very, very poor town of Orange, but they had this remarkable 300-acre wetlands in the middle of the town. And this is, this lake right here, most of the citizens of Orange didn't even know it existed. It had once been owned by the wealthiest citizen of the town. He had had a beautiful azalea garden around this lake. He had dug a lake out of wetlands, and it was just kind of an ornamental lake, and then there was a freeze, and it killed all his azaleas, and it broke his heart, and he just kind of forgot about this 300 acres in the middle of the town. Classic, you know, story that you can find. But anyway, our job on this case, we had this remarkable high school teacher who had found that nature was a really amazing teacher for these kind of poor little urban kids, and that he started these environmental programs, and he started building lots of kids that were interested in the sciences. A very successful program, and so ultimately the foundation went to him and said, let's do something with this, let's make an education facility out of these 300 acres. And so these 300 acres, here it is, and this is the town of Orange. It's a, you know, it's a pretty small, you know, 20,000 person town, but, and this was this lake that was dug out. Oh, ultimately, the reason I showed that pretty photograph is that after it went, the lake went to seed, it then became an amazing heronry, and so in the middle of the town, there is this really great bird sanctuary. But because it had been dug out of the wetlands, by the time we're showing up, the water is incredibly polluted from all the birds, polluted from the fact that there's no circulation through the water. So it was quite a challenge to do something with that lake. And then the other challenge was, how do you take something that was been kind of left to seed, has amazing wildlife in it, and then start to introduce it to the public and not screw it up? So what we thought of is we thought of the main program, again, is this education center of classrooms and offices and, you know, exhibition spaces and things like that. We thought of put the main building on the edge in the transition zone. Use it as the transition between the more urban place and this wonderful, big, vibrant landscape. And then we thought, since we had the challenges of the lake, we thought, well, if we thought of most of this building as what we called an infrastructure building, a building that is just all about the lungs and the restoration systems of the natural area. I'm supposed to go to that one. And then we had some other opportunities for education facilities that were out in the landscape, and I'll come to that in a second. So this is the notion of this program. I mean, it's a series of buildings that start to make space, series of courtyards adjacent to a busy street, but the heart of the campus of buildings was a wetlands. Now, a wetlands done in a really artistic way, but a wetlands cleansing system where we could drag the water from this polluted pond, oxygen-starved pond, and show how wetlands and wetland systems can start to heal the landscape. And then the building surrounding all that is all about, you know, environmental systems, collecting rainwater, where the water goes into ponds. This was the very first platinum project, I think, in the Gulf Coast. And then thinking of the buildings as collection areas, outdoor classrooms, so a lot of program space that went on in an outdoor environment, because the idea was connect more to the environment, a lot of outdoor circulation. A lot of the exhibitry happens out on these big porches, these generous porches. And then this wetland system. We did this with Jeff Carbo and Mesa landscape architects that are both from Dallas and Louisiana, but they're LSU graduates. And then when we did work out into the landscape, we were really light about how we worked out there. Again, it was kind of like that hawk viewing tower. We had a hurricane that went through when we were building this project. It knocked down a lot of the big pine trees, so we recycled a lot of those pine trees in these kind of outdoor classrooms. A lot of these classrooms, well, this whole classroom here is all screened off the grid, so using very little energy when we went out into the landscape. When we approached the lake, instead of having just these paths that would go along the lake, we only went to one little spot on the lake, and you had to hide behind all these slats to appreciate this bird sanctuary beyond in the lake. And then one of my favorite things we did is we came up with this notion of, well, how are we going to move people through this landscape? So rather than putting trails out in the space, the only way you can actually go to these outdoor remote classrooms is to go in this one bayou that we have in an electric boat, this really quiet little boat. You get an organized group. You go to these remote classrooms, and you're exploring the edge of the preserve, and then you land at these little, they're almost like boats in the middle of a big open landscape. So, and then these separate classrooms were completely off the grid, it was a great way to again introduce this community to the power of the environment. Well. We actually do a lot of urban projects. I'm just kind of just running you through our philosophy, and the notion is just our approach to sustainability here. But the urban landscape is incredibly important. Obviously, as you here in Philadelphia, you're doing a remarkable job. It's really one of the great American cities. It's been really fun being here. But in San Antonio, it's like a lot of Western cities. They really almost encouraged development beyond the edges, and so the downtowns have really been hit hard. Parking lots were the norm, a lot of open space. It's probably one of the most fragile landscapes in the West is our towns, and so in San Antonio we're very, very involved in our core of the city. We do, our offices are right down there. We do a lot of work in the inner city. But one of the most recent projects that we've done that we're very excited about is this 25-acre redevelopment of a brewery that was only a mile from downtown. And this is an older photograph of what that brewery once looked like. In reality, if I were to show you this photograph, which I'm not quite sure but it was really basically mainly a big open space with a few really sexy kind of older brewery buildings. But the developer was not your traditional developer. He bought it because he had a lot of other investments, and because he was very financially sound, he could take some time. And so what we did was we used it as an opportunity to bring in a lot of citizens in the city and say, hey, what can you do with 25 acres? You know, you don't want to spin it off. You want to make a destination. You want to make a real place. And then ultimately, you want to really transform this part of downtown. And the client really did embrace that idea. We now have a culinary institute going into this space, a lot of housing. And the San Antonio River comes up through this area, and so the restoration of this end of the San Antonio River so you can take a barge from here into downtown was a really critical piece. But a lot of what we needed to do was somehow fill in. So a lot of this, very little of this black is existing, the kind of obvious round thing and a few others. But every little building that existed on the campus was important. But to our client, you know, the older buildings were critical, but some of the old sheet metal bottling buildings seem to have no value. But we were able to convince him that, look, you don't right now have enough program to fill the space anyway. We've got to fill the space. Let's just start to think about, well, sorry. So first we thought a lot about the quality of the life along the river, and so we've created a lot of great kind of active spaces, destination spaces, amphitheater spaces, a lot of program spaces along the river. But then we thought of these kind of just really derelict, just sheet metal buildings. This is the finished product, so it's not supposed to look derelict anymore. But it did look derelict, and still maybe kind of does look derelict. But on this project, we convinced him that, you know, one of the beautiful things about this property is just the notion of that it's a brewery, and so let's not take anything away from the site. So we really recycled practically everything, and in this case, this was a sheet metal building that to him had no value, and the advantage to us was since it didn't have any value to our client, we were able to convince him that, well, we could do some big open cuts through the space, outdoor circulation spaces, and that's what this is. So the heart of this simple sheet metal building has become a very popular building for even for weddings and all kinds of things, but it's this kind of this free space that normally you would not have been able to do if the building had been more precious, more important to the client. And the other thing that we were able to do is, since we were involved very early on in the notion of how to program the building, is that we all started talking about the importance of sustainability. He was already doing something that was highly sustainable, which is to redevelop 25 acres right near downtown, bring people in, do housing, all the kind of, you know, highly sustainable things. But why not have the buildings also express that? And he got it. And so the building, one of the major branding things about the Pearl is that it's a sustainable development. So it has, as you walk through the building, and there's also a lot of, you know, kind of farmers market kind of project programs that go on too. But the building itself has, at the time that we finished it, it had more photovoltaics than any other building in Texas. But anyway, that's probably not sustainable a whole lot. But then we, you know, this whole notion of rainwater and the preciousness of water and using the old, you know, the beer containers for collecting rainwater. So you know, a few years ago, as we all experienced, there was a major slowdown in the world of architecture, and we thought, okay, well, it should be, you know, a crisis should show you that it should be an opportunity. And so since things were a little bit slower, we thought, well, let's do what we've always wanted to do. Let's go back to our roots when we were doing these small houses. You know, at this point in our lives, we're actually doing really, really expensive big houses. And so, but beyond that, let's, you know, we've now been doing this for 30 years. You know, could we do houses in a simpler way? Could we touch more people? Could we bring design to more people in a simpler, easier, and sustainable manner? And so we developed this notion of the porch house. And it's had a life of its own. It's been very exciting for me. It's taken many, many different turns. But the idea was for us is if something is going to be, you know, quote, prefabricated, it still had to be what we know, which is, and what we love, which is making buildings like this that are really particular to their place, that have, that you're able to round up space and have outdoor spaces and indoor spaces, and not one solution fits all. You know, every site deserves a different solution, like this one. Another one that we had, you know, that you know, where the living is over here and bedrooms are over here in a two-story space, and, you know, how could we do spaces like this? Outdoor spaces, actually that's an interior glass space, but big outdoor porches and bedrooms and kitchen, you know, these kind of service. Anyway, how could we do a building system as we designed? And so what we came up with is to do separate rooms built in a factory and then delivered to the site, and all the connecting tissue is the porches. And that's why we call it the porch house. So, and a pretty simple idea. The orange thing, you can buy two or three different living room things, and the green things represent the bedrooms, and you're, you know, four or five different bedroom systems, and you can just You can come to our office and you say, I want two of those, one of those. And then, but the big thing is there's still a lot of design that happens. You still have to organize these rooms. How do you make space in the landscape? Do you stack it? Do you make courtyards? So there's still a lot of flexibility in it, but there, because we're building in the factory, there's a great deal of consistency. And the quality is consistent. We found that doing projects in more remote locations, and by the way, we're conceiving this, at least first iteration, as really situations where people that needed to build something in slightly more remote locations, where construction costs are a little higher, where quality is always harder to find, that's where this is really headed. And then once we got scale, perhaps we could break into other markets. But the idea is that while these guys are building in a factory, and this is a factory near College Station, so it's all Aggies, and so they're doing a really good job. And then while we're doing that, Texas A&M, Aggies, I don't know. usually that just draws all kinds of laughter. But anyway, and then while we're having those things built in a factory, we're doing the construction on site, and so this is kind of how it works. And then these are the rooms, and so we're thinking as much about the spaces between the rooms as the rooms themselves. They can be clad in a variety of ways. The real exuberance of the design comes in these porch spaces, these kind of outdoor spaces where you can start to show all the texture of a building because the insides are pretty clean and simple sheetrock. But here, you know, the idea of these special spaces, a rolling, big rolling door that can show you how you can have a space like this that's pleasant, and when it's cold and windy, you just close it and it's open. Those kinds of, so still a lot of special design opportunities, simple rooms, 10-foot ceilings, 10-foot tall doors and windows, things like that. And a very, very classic kind of, you know, balanced daylighting, single wide rooms that encourage cross ventilation. So, and we're doing a number of projects currently in a variety of areas in Texas where we're stacking them and we're creating courtyards. And so these are going on as we speak. It's a two-story one that we're doing out in Colorado. But what's been interesting about all that is that it's we never really could get, this is 4 years later now or 3 years later, and we're still not doing a whole lot of these, and I don't think we're really hitting the public like we were thinking we would when we first began. While all that's been going on, you know, we've been having the same kind of situations that you've had in Pennsylvania, although in South Texas, oil fracking is not as sensitive of a situation because of a lot of the fact that it is a less populated area, it's a lot simpler conditions. But nevertheless, it's an enormous disaster in the sense of housing. And this is what's getting built all in South Texas, just this grim stuff. And all this land for lease, and it's just people are just building horrible stuff, and you never know how long the oil play is going to last in South Texas. But it is a crisis that you really don't want to miss out on, at least I don't. And we would love to think, the great optimists, that we could make a difference in this situation. And so that's what we're doing. So we're doing now a new iteration, a little less expensive porch house, a little bit shorter. We've learned actually a lot from, we had so much stuff that we would build out on the site, the connecting tissue, that we found that there was as much construction that would happen out on the site as in the factory. And that starts to really go cross purposes to the notion of efficiency and even cost. And so what we're now doing is creating units where even the flaps, they come from the factory completely finished, and you roll them into place. And what we're doing is we're using the opportunity to create housing. Now, it's going to be much higher quality housing for oil field workers down in South Texas than they're used to. And they won't necessarily pay a whole lot more rent. But the rent is still so good that, and the notion that we have, we're making these now out of concrete floors, so stiff floor with helical piers, pretty easy to put down. The idea is that you can reposition them, you can redeploy them in another area. Because one of the great challenges down in South Texas is the notion that these things are getting built, and the reason they're built so poorly is that they probably aren't going to be necessary after 8 or 10 years. But in this way, we can build something in a quality manner that's built to last for 50, et cetera, years, because we're imagining that they can be redeployed. And most importantly for us is that it's allowing us to create scale, finally, to this project. So you saw a lot on that. I'm going to close with this little film, just to, you know, just because it's fun.
This old port's just a big old red and white herping bull standing under a mesquite tree. And I would do to Texas, who just keeps home playing hide and seek with that hot August sun. He's sweating and a patting, cause his work is never done. Oh no, he got them cows and that red top cane. This old port's just a steaming greasy plate of enchiladas with lots of cheese and onions, a guacamole salad. You can get them at the LaSalle Hotel in old downtown with iced tea and a waitress who'll smile every time. Oh no, I love them junior mints and them red-eyed stares. I do